God this week for several things, and the Holy Spirit put on my heart something that I hadn't thought of in a while, but to believe God for the double portion. And I started thinking about it, you know, and that, you know, we have believed God for double portion. We believe, you know, God is so good. He's done so many things for us, right? You know, I think back on all the wonderful things that God has done for us and God will continue to do for us. So I want to read you this scripture. If you know anything about when we began Word of Life Ministries International, there's a clear mission of what God would have us do. And there's a definite blessing of that obedience. We're anointed because God has anointed us. That means that we're not ever doing this mission alone. Amen? And so God has called each of us, each and every one of us, to Word of Life Ministries International. And in that calling, there's a corporate anointing for all of us together to fulfill the mandate that is before us. Look at your Bibles to Isaiah chapter 61. And in that, we're going to find the double portion. It says, "The Spirit of the Sovereign Lord is on me, because the Lord has anointed me to preach the good news to the poor. He sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim freedom for the captives and release from darkness the prisoners, and to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." So just do this with me. We can proclaim that 2017 is the year of the Lord's favor. Amen. In my life. Amen? So say that with me. 2017 is the year of the Lord's favor.
Is the year of the Lord's favor.
In my life.
In my life.
Amen? Amen. And so, to comfort all who mourn, to provide for those who all who grieve in Zion, and bestow on them a crown of beauty instead of ashes, the oil of gladness instead of mourning, the garment of praise instead of a spirit of despair. They shall be called the oaks of righteousness, a planting of the Lord for a display of his splendor. They will rebuild the ancient ruins and restore the places long devastated. They will renew the ruined cities, for they have been devastated for generations. Aliens will shepherd your flocks. Foreigners will work your fields and vineyards, and you will be called the priests of the Lord. You will be named the ministers of God, of our God. You will feed on the wealth of the nations, and in their riches you shall boast. Instead of their shame, my people will receive a double portion. Instead of their disgrace, they will rejoice in their inheritance, and they will inherit a double portion in their land, and everlasting joy shall be theirs. And so I've been praying about the double portion. I've been praying about what it is to have a double portion, what it means to walk in the double portion, and what God wants for us in that double portion. In that double portion, when we read in Isaiah chapter 61, it pertains to something that has been taken away. Something has been stolen. Well, I think that it's safe to say that what we see in our lives, especially in the last 10 years, we've seen it taken away. We've seen some things stolen. We see the enemy coming against people. We see whether the enemy is trying to steal your health, whether the enemy is trying to steal your finances or your families. And so we understand that there's a fight, there's a contention, there's a pushing back. And so there's a resistance going on, that we're resisting the devil, and he has to do what? He has to flee from us. Amen? But in that resistance, our God is faithful to say that he's not going to steal from you, and if he takes anything from you, you're going to receive double. Praise God. So look at your neighbor and tell your neighbor, double. Amen?
Double.
Double. Double. I believe 2017 is the double year. Praise God. The double year. The year that we receive double. 2 Corinthians 1:21, if you want to turn there in your Bibles. How many of you brought your Bibles today? Praise God. That's your sword. That's your weapon. Now, 2 Corinthians 1:21 says, "Now it is God who makes us both us and you stand firm in Christ. He anointed us. He set his seal of ownership on us and put his Spirit on our hearts as a deposit, guaranteeing what is to come." So let's say this together. I'm anointed
to
do what God
to do what God has called me to do.
Let's say it again. I'm anointed.
I'm anointed.
To do what God has called me to do.
To do what God has called me to do.
I'm anointed.
I'm anointed.
To do what God has called me to do.
To do what God has called me to do.
Why do I make you guys say this? Because I want to help you get it in your spirit, and when you say it and when you speak it, it gets down on the inside of you. You are anointed to do what God has called you to do. Amen?
Amen.
And so what has God called us to do? Well, when we read in Isaiah 61, what God has called us to do is to preach the good news. What is the good news? Well, the good news to the poor is that they don't have to be poor anymore. Amen?
Amen.
The good news to the brokenhearted is that their hearts will be healed. The good news to those who are in bondage is that they can be set free. And the good news to those in darkness is that they can come into the light. So we are called to proclaim and tell people that they have the favor of God. You know, I've heard a lot of people say that, you know, God has not called them to preach, and I disagree. Maybe you're not a pastor, maybe you're not a preacher, maybe you don't have a platform like this, but we're all called. If you're a born-again believer, then I believe this passage is anointing you and calling you to preach the good news, no matter what your vocation are. We are all called. Let's say that together. I am called.
I am called.
I am called. We are all called. We are all called to share the gospel of what God has done for us. Has God changed you? Has God done something for you? Well, I know that He has. Did God pick you up where you were and set your feet on the right course? Did God save you from yourself? You were supposed to die lots of years ago, but you didn't die, did you? You're still here, right? Still here, proclaiming God's grace, proclaiming God's love. We are anointed and we are called to tell of the goodness of God to those who don't know His goodness. Amen?
Amen.
And there's a lot of people out there that don't know His goodness. So you are called. You are anointed. And I just want to encourage you today to start speaking up. So start saying, start talking, start ministering. Every morning, our prayer to the Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit, lead me to the people you want me to talk to today. Amen? Because we are God's witnesses. So look at your neighbor and tell them you're anointed.
You're anointed.
You are anointed. Let's look at Colossians 1:28. And say amen when you get there. Colossians 1:28. We proclaim Him, admonishing and teaching everyone with all wisdom, so that we may present everyone perfect in Christ. Amen?
Amen.
So we've been called to witness. We have a witness on the inside of us. We have a witness of what God has done for us. We have a witness. Listen, nobody can tell your story like you. Right?
Amen.
Nobody can tell your story like you. And I find that the biggest attraction is when someone speaks from their heart, tells their story, and lets people know, this is who my God is, this is what He did for me, and He'll do the same for you. Isn't that attractive? It draws you in, doesn't it? And so nobody can tell your story but you, and you all have a story to tell. Sometimes what happens, we get all bogged down in life and things are happening. We get distracted. We're not in the Word as much as we should be. And then things are happening all around us. And then our story gets a little stale. Our story gets a little dull. Our story, why did we lose the fire? Right? Well, I want to tell you, don't let that happen. Stir yourself up, like it says in 2 Timothy 1:6. Stir up the gift that's in you. Stir up your story. Stir up your testimony. Stir up for what God has done for you. Stir yourself up. If you want to see revival in our land, and how many of us want to see revival in our land? And I'm just talking Riverside, California, the United States. We want to see revival. Well, revival happens with the church first. Amen?
Amen.
It's us. It's the church. Mm-hmm. It's the Christians. We are the ones that have to be revived. We are the ones that have to remember who it is that lives on the inside of us. We are the ones that have to think back and know that God did this for me, He can do this for you. And we are the ones that have to speak out. And so revival lives in me.
lives in me.
And so that means you got to stir yourself up. I shouldn't have to pull your teeth every Sunday to get you stirred up. Now that went over really well. I'm going to say it again. Right? I shouldn't have to pull teeth. I shouldn't have to pull teeth to get you stirred up. You should come in here stirred up. You should come in here ready. Has God done something for you?
Amen.
Has he? I know he has. He's a good God. And he's worthy of our praises. And he's worthy of our testimony. And he's been so good to you. And when you get into a mode of praise and you get into a mode of worship, you're not going to need to be stirred up because you're going to stay continually stirred up. Amen?
Amen.
Continually stirred up. Continually stirred up. And don't, you know, get yourself into a rut, you know. And a lot of people don't like a lot of things that happen in Pentecostal churches. They don't like it when there's sometimes too much manifestation of the Holy Spirit, where people are running around or whatever. And you know, none of that bothers me. I don't care about that stuff. You know what bothers me more? What bothers me more is when people refuse to let the Holy Spirit work in their lives. Amen? Amen. Get loose. Let God work in you. Let God do his thing. We can trust the Holy Spirit, right? Amen. So get yourself stirred up before you come to church. Come in here with an atmosphere of praise. Come in here with an atmosphere of worship. And that's my admonishment to you today. Why do we got in challenge? We got to stir ourselves up because it's so easy to get in a rut. It's so easy to fall in a rut, isn't it? It's so easy. You know, we get tired, we work, you know, get tired, and then, you know, I'm feeling kind of lazy. It's just easy just to check out for a little bit, you know, and watch TV, or some people play video games, or some people do other stuff. It's just easy to check out. But I got to tell you, we're living in a day and age where God doesn't want us to check out. He wants us to stay engaged. He wants us to stay connected because he wants to do something in your life. So stop resisting him. He's trying to get the double to you. Double what? The double anointing. The double favor. The double of whatever it is that you need in your life. He's trying to get that to you. Amen? And so we got to be open and receive what God has for us. So everybody just raise your hands for just a moment. We just tell God, I receive it and I take it. Amen? I receive it and I take it. I receive it and I take it. Praise God. Hallelujah. So, what are we called to do? We're called to proclaim and tell people that God loves them and that they have God's favor. Oh, praise God. Let's say this together. I am proclaimed.
I am proclaimed.
I am called, excuse me, I am called to proclaim.
I am called to proclaim.
The word of God.
The word of God.
Amen. We're called to proclaim that. Who are we? Well, we read in Isaiah that we are the oaks of righteousness. We are a display of the Lord's splendor. In other words, we are the manifestation of the goodness and glory of God here on earth. God's presence is on us. We are to live a life worthy of that presence. Amen? A life worthy of that presence. You know, God saved me. God lifted me out from the pit. God gave me a course where I need to go, and I got to stay on that course, right? And you too, we stay on that course. We listen to that path that God has called us to do. And in doing that, we've got to understand that we are righteous and that we are holy and that God has called us to a particular way. Amen? Romans chapter 3, verse 22. The righteousness from God comes through faith in Jesus Christ to all who believe. Any believers here? Any believing believers? You're a believing believer? We're believing believers, aren't we? Believing believers. And so God has called us, and God has made us righteous, and God has made us holy. And then the next verse says, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God and are justified freely through his grace through redemption that came by Christ Jesus. And so we know that all have fallen short of the glory of God. We know that we have fallen short of the glory of God. But thank God that He calls us righteous, that we're no longer sinners, right? We're no longer sinners saved by grace, but now we are oaks of righteousness. We're righteous and we're holy. And so what will we do? We are builders and restorers. Isaiah 61 says they will restore their cities. They will rebuild their land. I don't know if you know, but there's a lot of pain in our land right now. There's a lot of people that are hurting. There's a lot of people that need to be restored. There's a lot of people that feel disconnected. There's a lot of people that want some answers. But God has given us, the body of Christ, the answers. He's given us the witness. He's given us the things that we need to reach this generation for the glory of God. We just need to talk. We just need to speak to them. And when you see at your place of employment somebody that's hurting, I know that sometimes you can't pray on the job and sometimes you can't do certain things, but you can say, I know you can because this is still America. This is still United States of America. The last time I checked, you can still say, I will pray for you. I will pray. You can say that. Amen. You can say, I will pray for you on your job. And if they ask you for prayer right then you can do it. You know, it's not against the law to be a Christian, contrary to popular belief. It's not against the law to be a Christian. And we can pray and we can allow the Holy Spirit to open that door if we will be so bold. So we're builders and restorers. And God is going to use us. This isn't going to get restored by itself. This isn't going to be restored without us. God is going to use His people to bring restoration. Amen? And so John 10:10, we know that scripture, Satan destroys and tears down, but we build up. The thief comes only but to steal, kill, and destroy. Jesus said that you might have, I come that you might have life, and life more abundantly. So we have Jesus on the inside. So if Satan destroys and tears down, we build up. We build up. We build up. How do we build up? We build up by our actions and we build up by our words. That's who we are. And so in our obedience to the word of God comes the blessing. The blessing and a double portion of what God has for us. So here's, you know, when I think about that. So we build up with our actions, but we also build up with our words. How do you build up with your words? You encourage people. You give an impartation to people. You look, instead of focusing on whatever's happening to you, you look at people and you speak a word of encouragement to them. Give them a scripture. Say a prayer for them. Speak some kind of encouragement. How many of us like encouragement, right? We all like encouragement. And look around you and ask the Holy Spirit, Lord, give me a word of encouragement for someone today. And do you know that He will? Because we are the oaks of righteousness. Amen? We're an oak of righteousness. Praise God. And so, here's the blessing. Isaiah 61 says, we're called to be the priest of the Lord. So we'll have a good reputation and name. And people will know us because of the God we serve. So, when you're on your place of employment, you have a reputation. And you want that reputation to be a flawless reputation. You want to have a good reputation. You want to give God a good name. And you want to walk in that anointing, in that power, and that righteousness that God has given to you. And when people see you at work, your place of employment, or at school, or wherever you are, hey, there goes Ryan. You know that kid, Ryan? He will pray for you if you ask him to. He will stand on the word of God. I don't understand it all, but I know God goes with Ryan, right? That's how people think. I don't really understand it all, but I know that God goes with him. I know that he talks to God and God listens. That's the way people talk, isn't it? Maybe they don't know God so much, but they recognize that you know God, and then they want to come to you because you know God, and that's your way to lead them to the Holy Spirit. Amen? Isn't God good? I want God to use me. Don't you want God to use you? And so the second part of the blessing is that we are wealthy and feed on the nations so much that we will boast about our goodness of God. Why does God bless you financially? So it's so you can hoard up and keep it to yourself, so when the apocalypse happens, you have plenty for you and your family. No, that is not why. and just so you guys know, the zombie apocalypse is not real. That's really not going to happen, okay? Just so you guys know that. No, why does God bless you? Why does he bless you? So you can be a blessing to others. You're blessed so it can be poured upon you and poured out. If you think of a glass being filled to the top, and the water is the blessing. So the glass fills a certain amount of the blessing. Well, and then the blessing comes on some more, and then there's more, and then there's more. And then the blessing comes up and out, and it's overflowing. When you're blessed, when your needs are taken care of and you have overflow, you're able to be a blessing to other people. You should be looking around. Lord, you've been such a blessing to me. Who can I bless today? Amen?
Amen.
And I'm not talking just about financial blessing. Again, it can be a word. It can be an impartation. It can be a prayer. One year for my birthday, somebody from another country contacted me and said, I am setting a whole day aside to pray for you on this day all day long because it's your birthday. Wow, that blessed me. That really blessed me to know that somebody would love me enough to pray for me all day long. Do you see what I'm saying? And so God, so the blessing is upon you. Say it, the blessing is on you.
The blessing is on
you. The blessing is on you so that you can be a blessing to other people. We are wealthy and feed the nation so much that we'll boast about the goodness of God. And so instead of shame, we'll be given double honor. We'll inherit a double portion in our land. You know, the blessing isn't for people who have one foot in church and one foot out in the world. The blessing is for people who are serious about God. Amen. For those who are willing to lay aside everything to serve their God. This is the double portion for 2017. However, it comes with a double challenge. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. You know, and sometimes things can happen and there can be obstacles and life can be rough and there can be all these mountains in our way. And we've certainly seen a lot of mountains, all of us, in the past few years. But I just want to encourage you, no matter what your mountain is, God has an answer for it. Amen? And there'll be people who will be in despair around you. And there'll be people who don't know what to do. And there'll be heartache and sorrow for those who don't know God. And there'll be times of great suffering, but God has a plan for those who follow him. So no matter what is happening in the world, no matter what is happening around you, you don't have to participate in that. Amen? You don't have to participate in what the world does. Because God has a plan for your life.
Amen.
Look at your name and say, God has a plan for me.
God has a plan for you.
God has a plan for me. Amen? Amen. And so what is it that we need to do? God has set me aside for this time to be a light and to bring the good news to the lost. And that if you choose in your heart to follow God in 2017 the way that you've never followed God before. Amen? That you are serious about following God, then you will see a double portion of the blessing poured out on you. What does that mean for you? What is required of you? Well, what is required is not playing games. If you have stuff that you're trying to deal with and it's got a hold on you and you can't let it go, well, that's what we're here for, to pray with you, to help hold you accountable, to teach you, to disciple you. Listen, you do not have to be mastered by anything. Amen? You master it. And you do that by your words. You do that. There's no shortcuts in this. It's getting in the Word. It's praying in the Spirit. It's getting in the Word. Praying in the Spirit. Getting in the Word. Amen?
Amen.
And that's how we overcome. That's how we do. We speak to those things. So, get rid of the sin in your life. Turn your life over to God once and for all. You might be thinking, well, I've done that. Well, I've done that. I did that. I've been a Christian, you know, for whatever long. Well, my challenge to you is this. You may have sin that's not apparent to those around you, but just for example, I'll just take this. If you walk in unforgiveness, then your heart's not right. If you're too proud to admit that you're wrong, then your heart's not right. If you lie for whatever reason, then your heart isn't right. Amen?
Amen?
If you lust after someone, then your heart's not right. If you think bad thoughts towards someone, your heart is not right. You know, we can look good on the outside sometimes and think bad stuff towards someone, then, you know, our heart is not right. The good news is that God doesn't approach us from the outside in. He speaks to us from the inside out. Amen?
Amen.
And He speaks to our heart, and He tells us. The good news is that He speaks to us on the inside of our heart. You know, sometimes as Christians, we can get off the path and allow things that aren't of God to invade our hearts. And I'm telling you today, with everything I have, that it's not worth it, it's not worth it, it's not worth it, it's not worth it. Don't let that garbage come in. It's like weeds. Do y'all have weeds in your yard? You've got to go out there. And once you get that one weed, and it's like, you know, they multiply, right? And they multiply, and there are more weeds. And then what is the weed trying to do? It's trying to choke out the grass, right? Well, our hearts are like the grass and the weeds, and the sin comes in and tries to choke out God in our heart. That's what it tries to do. And when you have something in your heart that's not out of God, that's not of God, judge yourself, pull that weed up, allow the Holy Spirit to forgive you. Right? All you have to do is just ask Him, forgive me, Lord, for thinking that thought. Forgive me for those words. Forgive me, God, for whatever it is. And allow Him to forgive you. And then you pulled up that weed in your heart. Amen? Don't let the weeds of this world choke out the Word of God in your heart. Amen? Don't do it. It's not worth it. And I got to tell you, the reason that it does, that a lot of Christians do allow that, is because we get lazy and don't get into the Word and into prayer. Amen?
Amen.
You got to stir yourself up. You got to stir yourself to pray. You got to stir yourself to hear the voice of God. You got to stir yourself to get into the Word. You have to do it. Amen? Not me. I can't do it for you. I can't even do it for my own kids. I can't do it for anybody but me. You can't do it for anybody but you. Amen? But it's God's will that everyone does it for themselves. God just wants a relationship with you. So much does He want a relationship with you that He sent His one and only Son to die on the cross. Amen?
Amen.
For our sins. And to give us all His righteousness, and we give Him all of our sins so that we can stand before God and be oaks of righteousness. Glory to God. So that we can be holy. Glory to God. We're not righteous and holy in of our own selves. We're righteous and holy because of everything that Jesus Christ did on the cross. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Why wouldn't I shout about that? Why wouldn't I talk about that? Because He saved me. Amen. He saved me. If that's the only testimony that you got, it's enough. He saved you from yourself. He brought you up out of that pit and that stinking thinking and all the things that used to go on in your life that have stopped now. Why? Because He has saved you from that.
Amen.
Glory to God. If you can't get excited about that, and I don't want you to check your pulse right now. Amen? He's a good God. He's a good God. And He's good to you. So look at your neighbor and say, He is so good to me.
He is so good to me.
So we got to get rid of that sin in our life and turn our life over to God once and for all. And if you've done that, great. But sometimes it creeps back in and you got to do it again. And my challenge is this. That you may not have sin that's apparent to those around you, but just check your heart. Do a heart check every day. And you know the heart check. You know, because the Holy Spirit lives on the inside of us. Said something a little too sharp. Oh, I said that a little too sharp. You know, once you say a word, you can't really take it back, right? So you said, I said that a little too sharp. And to the person you're talking to, I'm sorry. Please forgive me. That sounded sharper than I meant it. I'm asking you for forgiveness. See? Just start teaching yourself. Start teaching yourself when you sin, when you say something you're not supposed to, when you do something. Start correcting yourself. If you want the double in your life, how many of you want the double? I can't afford to block any of my blessings that the Holy Spirit has for me. Amen?
Amen.
I want the double in my life. Check yourself. When you say something, when you think something. Now, God, why did I think that thought? I know that's not of you. Well, say it out loud. I bind that in Jesus' name. Lord, I want to think on what's pure. I want to think on what's holy. I want to think on what is righteous. I want to think on what's lovely. And you train your thoughts. Amen? You train your thoughts to think the right kind of thoughts.
Amen.
You know, somebody comes in and they just rub you the wrong way. And you think in yourself, I wish I could just go up and, you know, trip them or something like that. Right? Right? Wow. You guys are really holy and righteous because y'all give me that one. Right? Nobody thought that? Thinks that? Right? We have those thoughts. Right? What are we supposed to do? Lord, please forgive me for thinking that stuff. I don't want to be like that. I want to be gracious to my enemies, right? I want to pour out God's love because let me tell you something. Some people that don't like you, it has nothing to do with you. It has to do with what's going on with them. Amen? And I want to tell you, some people don't like you because the Spirit in them isn't aligning with the Spirit in you. And since you have the Holy Spirit, and you come along, that Holy Spirit convicts them. That's why they don't want to be around you at Thanksgiving and Christmas. You hear what I'm saying? It's because you convict them. Your Spirit is convicting. Thank God. I want to have a Holy Spirit in me that convicts people. Amen?
Amen.
But I got to be strong enough in God to overlook the things that the devil may be doing in somebody else towards me. For we walk, we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against powers, amen, against powers in high places. That's what we do. So we take authority over that stuff because who needs to hear the gospel? The ones that don't like you need to hear the gospel. The ones that are grumpy need to hear the gospels. The ones that think that God has forgotten them, that's the ones that need to hear the gospel. Are y'all hearing this morning?
Amen.
So the good news is God doesn't approach us from outside, but he speaks to us on the inside of our hearts. And so we got to stay on the path. We got to stay on the path at all costs. So you have a choice in 2017. You have a choice to continue on the path that you're on. And that you have to make a decision that you're going to be sold out to God 100%. Sold out to God 100%. Would you give your last dollar to someone who needed it because God asked you to? Would you apologize and keep peace even though you think you're right? Would you allow me to be your pastor and challenge you even though you don't like it sometimes and submit? These are questions, right? But more importantly, would you submit to God and allow him to challenge you? And there's a part of all of us that wants to be in control. Would you lay aside control and allow God to be the Lord of your life? You know, and I'm big on declarations because I believe as we speak it, it gets down in our heart. And we speak it again, and it gets down in our heart more. And that we stand on that word, and that we have what we say. And we're going to make some declarations, but before we do, I just want you to know, if you don't mean it, then don't say it. Amen? If you don't mean it, then just don't say it. You want everybody to think you're saying it and you're not, just move your mouth and say watermelon or something, you know? But here's the deal. I'm encouraging you to say it. I'm encouraging you to challenge yourself. Challenge yourself. Challenge your spirit. Move closer to God. Everybody wants the great things of God. Everybody wants God to move great in their life. Everybody wants all these wonderful things to happen. But let me tell you, folks, it takes commitment. It takes obedience. It takes listening to the Holy Spirit. That is the path of blessing. Amen? That's the path of blessing. quite frankly, if God tells you to do something, you just do your own thing. Don't expect to see that blessing in your life. But with obedience comes the blessing of God, and He wants you to be blessed. Amen. He wants to pour out that blessing on you like you've never, ever seen before. I'm ready for it. How about you?
Amen.
Amen. Well, let's stand to our feet and let's say these things. And only you know, it's between you and God. Only you know, if you mean it. Lord, I give you control of my life. Once and for all. No more hidden parts of me. I want my life to be open for all to see. I declare in 2017, I'm walking in your righteousness. I'm walking in your holiness.
I'm walking in your holiness.
I desire to be separated from the world.
I desire to be separated from the world.
And walk in obedience to your word.
And walk in obedience to your word.
God, forgive me for not listening to you.
God, forgive me for not listening to you.
I open my ears to hear your voice.
I open my ears to hear your voice.
In 2017. And I heed your voice.
And I heed your voice.
This year is different from any other year.
This year is different from any other year.
I lay down any rebellion.
I lay down any rebellion
that I may have in my heart.
That I may have in my heart.
And choose to walk in the anointing.
And choose to walk into the anointing.
In favor of God.
In favor of God.
I choose to obey your word.
Choose to obey your word.
In all past experiences.
In all past experiences.
Of doubt, fear, and unbelief are gone.
In doubt, fear, and unbelief are gone.
I choose to walk in faith.
I choose to walk in faith.
In 2017.
In 2017.
In spite of past experiences.
In spite of past experiences.
I believe, Lord, your word.
I believe, Lord, your word.
That tells me I have a double portion.
That tells me that I have a double portion.
I receive that double portion.
I receive that double portion.
And I vow,
and I vow,
to be available to you, Lord,
to be available to you, Lord,
whenever,
however,
you call me. This is my year.
This is the time that I break free
of everything that's holding me back. This is my year.
This is my year.
This is my year.
This is my year.
And nothing is going to keep me from receiving my double portion.
Not myself.
Not the devil.
Not other people.
This is my year of the double. Now let's thank Him and praise Him and give Him all the glory. We thank you, Jesus. We give you glory, Father. We give you honor, Lord. You are so good to us. You are so